the interaction with the Puratos family and what they call the Puratos magic, they really listen to what the people working in Puratos has to say. In this year and a half that I've been there, I've seen changes based on this polls or exercises with or workshops with the employees and also with the whole Puratos family. So I think that's where the family-owned label, if we want to mention like this, you feel it.
Welcome to the Chemical Engineering Guys podcast, a show in which we share stories and tips from chemical and process engineers. We talk about student and professional life, as well as important aspects of products, processes, industries, and companies. But more importantly, what are the paths that these unique individuals are taking in this ever-changing world? Let's get started.
So what's up, guys? Welcome to another episode, this time with the legendary Jose Luis Farias. This guy is one of my best friends from the university. He also studied chemical engineering. And actually, I already did an interview with him. We did it back, I think, 4 to 5 years ago. And we talked about he and how he landed a job in Belgium. He always dreamt about going out of Mexico and apply his knowledge. And I'm really happy and grateful that you made it, Jose Luis. I know it's not easy with the new situation and the change in times, but you are right here. So I don't know what you want to tell us about you, but I think the only person that is best suited for this is you. So tell us about you. What did you do in the university? Why did you wanted to go to these companies? And what do you do currently?
Well, thank you, Emma. Hello, everybody. First of all, thank you for the invitation. I feel honored of being part of this second batch of interviews. And I feel also flattered since I know all the engineers and friends that are going to be or were already interviewed. So thank you very much for the invitation. Well, my name is Jose Farias. I study chemical engineering in Monterrey with Emmanuel. I'm from a small town in Mexico called Colima. And after finishing my studies in Monterrey, I went back to my hometown and I worked for Jacobs Engineering with being our main client, DuPont Nutrition and Health. There, I was process engineer, part of an engineering department. I worked there for 1 year and 4 months. And as Emmanuel mentioned, I always had like the ambition to work abroad. And I ended up in Belgium, mainly because I wanted also to not only to work abroad, but to work in a foreign language. And since I learned French at high school, I decided to come here. And I was really, really lucky to find a job. And I work first for Altran Benelux as a consultant, being our main customer, GSK, in their bag science division. There, I was also a process engineer in the first year. And the second year, I was part of a project where I got a lot of interaction with our colleagues from Altran India. So this was a really good experience. But as you know, pharma sometimes requires a lot of time for not a lot of engineering. So that's why I decided to move to another consultancy company called Greenfish, where I did more engineering. And as a good millennial, after a couple of years there, I decided to change again. And now I work for Puratos. It's a food ingredient company, Belgian-owned multinational, where I'm a project engineer in the headquarters. And I'm in charge of doing engineering projects around the world. So in a nutshell, briefly, this is my short experience. And yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, I'm from Mexico and I live here in Brussels, Belgium.
Nice. I think you have one of the most interesting profiles I've been interviewing, especially because you have a lot of process engineering. You have a lot of industries. You said nutrition and health, pharma. Right now you're in, I don't know, if food industry, patisserie and bread. Baking. I don't know. I think it's always very great to have a lot of areas that you have been working for, because then you can apply at different industries, different projects, different companies, and different roles. So that's great. Jose Luis, congratulations in having this great resume. And previously we were talking about your internship. I think we didn't mention it right now, but can you tell us a little bit on your Coca-Cola internship? Why did you decide to do it? How was it related to your field? And if it helped you to get the, say, your first recently graduate job?
Yes, I did one internship in Coca-Cola company in my hometown in Colima, as in the wastewater treatment plant. I was basically a lab assistant. Was in charge of doing the analysis of the COD, the VOD, the suspended solids and nitrates, just to do the analysis and register and see that the plant was within ranges. And the reason why I did this internship was because I wanted to know, or I wanted to see it or to feel it in the field. What was it to be an engineer, or no, not an engineer, a chemical engineer, before doing my studies, just to check, to validate for investing 4 years and a half of my life. And also this experience helped me to get to know the process of the wastewater treatment plant, but also in Coca-Cola. So it was really a first experience with an industry, and the people I met, the experience that I had were really, really good. So that's why I decided to study chemical engineering in Monterrey. This didn't really help me to get my first job. What it did was the type of courses that we had at the university, like design of chemical plants, thermodynamics. We had a specific class on reactors. So all these chemical engineering courses really, really helped me. Also, they were looking for someone young and also someone that could speak English for the people in Jacobs and DuPont in the US. So it was more these three aspects that really helped me to get my first job.
So your first recently graduate job, will you say it's because you had very chemical engineering or process engineering subjects related to your field? Because you were able to speak English and because you were young and fitting the profile. So that's how will you summarize this?
Yes, yes.
Okay. And I know Jacobs Engineering, as you have been telling me from years ago, it's a very interesting area because it allows to work directly in process design and process startup. Tell us a little bit more on what's Jacobs Engineering, what do they do, what did you do, and whatever you think it's relevant to add to Jacobs Engineering.
So yeah, Jacobs Engineering is basically an engineering company that helps a lot of type of clients to perform their CapEx and engineering projects. I was, as I mentioned, Jacobs Engineering, process engineering for DuPont Nutrition and Health, and there I was part of an engineering department where we received all the CapEx projects for the year or the years to come. And there we were in charge of performing the what we call the front-end project or front-end engineering from a feasibility or conceptual design, estimate the budget with the correspondent accuracy in this stage, then present it, pass the gate review, and then go to a basic engineering, detail engineering contact. After the detail engineering, be in contact with suppliers in charge of process equipment, of valves, of instruments, and also the suppliers in charge of doing the actual installation and assisting the startup. So that was my role, to participate in these projects. And yeah, that's basically what I did and what Jacobs Engineering, they do. They sell a project for a different type of contracts, fixed term or whatever, and deliver a project.
Essentially, they were contractors for Dow.
Yeah, we were contractors for engineering.
Okay, yes. Nice. That's very interesting to hear, especially here in Mexico, which is not that heard that there are companies making or doing engineering for other important companies. So what do you think about that? Did you like it, or was it more like it's indifferent?
I think it was my experience or the fact that there are not so many. I think it was a good start, a really, really, really good start on the engineering world, and also to know if design and process engineering itself was a thing that I would really try to make my career evolve. And I think that there are not a lot of, honestly, I don't know if there are a lot or not companies assisting other major companies, but I think that there should be, but we really don't know.
Okay. My main question now is, why did you decide to change? Or I'm pretty sure that since you graduated, you wanted to go abroad. So you took this job, and I'm sure also that you were like always with this little, I don't know how to say it, bothering your brain that I need to go out. How did you achieve that change from going to a engineering service company in Mexico to the company which is named Altran Belux as a junior consultant? How did you achieve that?
This first experience exactly was that. It gave me an experience that I could eventually sell afterwards. And during this year, while I was working, I was also applying abroad, applying on directly on the company's web pages, applying by LinkedIn, applying in a lot of means and a lot of ways. And I was really, really lucky that in Altran Benelux they were looking for someone like me. Also, was speaking English, because the project in Belgium was with people from the UK that spoke a bit of French, and that it had not a lot of experience, but experience enough to be able to be again into a CapEx team. And that was pretty much it. Again, I was really, really, really lucky that there were looking for someone like me, young and cheap, and eager and motivated. And I think that's sometimes that's what they look for in specific positions.
I think so. They want energy.
They want energy.
Which is motivated and willing to work. And if you guys want to know more, we did an episode which is 4 or 5 years old. So if you want to check out more into how Jose Luis used LinkedIn to get that job, I think it's very interesting. Back in the day, it was not that common to use LinkedIn.
It was not that common, yeah.
Right now, it's, I would say, one top three ways to get the job. So talking about this, can you explain us more on what exactly is CapEx or CapEx? And what do you say that much in Altran Belux?
Well, CapEx basically is capital investment. Is what company redirects how to make it simple. Basically, it's money that you invest with the mission or like with the objective of getting an outcome.
So instead of taking it out to the investors, you take it back to the company?
You take it back to the company and you create it into a new asset. It's something new that you will buy, and there is something new that will start depreciation, that depreciated, and is something new that it can either help you to, well, in my case, I'm just talking about my case, either can help you to increase your capacity or just put a new set of offices. Is anything that you require, that you require to invest to have actually an outcome. Really good question.
Okay.
Because we talk about a lot, but then to define it is not.
I know. But I remember to hear that a lot in the university, but I didn't pay that much attention until I got to my first job and they were talking about now the CapEx. And I was like, what's that? So I think it's important to know what is.
It's capital expenditure.
How do you spend capital? So it sounds very fancy, but it's a lot of difference between money, capital. So it's more into the actual money that could go back to the investors and as a company get lost. So yeah, it's like to reinvest it in the company.
Yeah.
And why Altran Belux needs that? Or what did you do related to that? So I know you have a lot of projects there. So can you tell us a little bit how do they work there?
A bit the same as in Jacob's engineering. We were improving a production line, and we were they were producing adhesives, and they needed to go from industrial adhesives, if we can say it this way, to GMP to be used in humans adhesives. My experience in DuPont being a food ingredient company, and also in close interaction and mindset of what GMP is, that's what really helped me to pass from the industrial adhesives to the GMP adhesives. And GMP is good manufacturing practices, before you ask.
just wondering. Thank you for getting
I'm joking.
Quick there. So I know that you work with GlaxoSmithKline Pharmaceuticals. Is that also like a contractor, or is it more like a client? How does that work? What do Altran Belux do there, and what do you help with?
It was as a contractor, as a what they call it here, as a consultant. The GSK, they outsource a lot of their day-to-day operations and also their CapEx projects. And there we also had our capital investment project, but it was a completely different world. Pharma, it requires a lot of protocols, a lot of procedures that sometimes take more time than the engineering and the implementation itself. So it was also a really good learning, but for me, it was a lot of paperwork than real engineering.
Paperwork, you mean like researching and making?
No,
reading.
For example, when you start and you create like it's called differently in different companies, but you create like an objective statement or a scope agreement or one pager, that they call it differently. But then you create one, and then there it has to be really, really, really long and as detailed and precise as possible. And then a lot of people have to sign it. And then maybe it takes like 2 months for one guy to sign. And so it gets really, 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 sometimes it gets really tricky and really complicated to do what is relatively simple stuff. But again, since in GSK there were vaccines, you cannot fool around. You have no room for error. So all of these protocols and all of these paperwork or revisions, they have a reason to exist. And also, for example, if during a startup, you have in pharma and also in life science or food industry, what is called like IQ or QMPQ, installation qualification, operation qualification and performance qualification. And there, again, you have a lot of paperwork, and this paperwork has to be checked by someone from quality and needs to be signed and dated and the date. I don't know. It's, yeah, but pharma was a really, really, really good experience. But
I get it. I think there is, it must be everything flawless, even documentation.
Yes.
So my question is then, how much percentage were you actually in the office? Were you going to plants, or how was the distribution of work?
The distribution of work was, I'll say, 50-50 between the site and in office. But in the project, I'll say it was 30% design and 70% paperwork in pharma.
So no, not that nice. No. 70% of your time doing paperwork doesn't sound that nice. Yeah. And my question is then, how did you devise the change? So the opportunity came, or were you looking forward for changing to Greenfish, or how does this new opportunity came around?
As a good millennial, it's always good to know your value in the market, and also just to know how the market is evolving. So I'll say that my transition to Greenfish and from Greenfish to where I am, Puratos, it was just looking around.
Strategical movements in order to improve your experience?
Both. I think both. It has to be from a day-to-day point of view. It has to be appealing what you're going to do. And also the how your career can evolve. So I was let's say okay, good, happy in Altran and as well and Greenfish. But then something else came along, then I just decided to take it.
So you're ambitious. Yeah. You want to get more and better jobs and better qualifications, I think.
Why not?
So that's very great. I think it's very necessary. Many people don't do that. Especially, I typically hear stories when they ask me or I hear that they are getting these new opportunities or they get these new interviews and they say, I don't know if I should be going. I'm happy where am I? And even though the job is better or maybe the pay is better, I'm happy here. So I will always at least say that go to the interview, check out what's about.
Exactly. What's there.
And maybe even if you want to stay, get that counter offer. So get to your boss and say, I have this offer, I may go. So what can you do with my current, maybe not cash or money. Yes. Maybe you want to get more responsibilities. Or maybe you want to do a certain project. You can always bargain and get a better deal that you have. And definitely that's very ambitious for ambitious people, because many of the people will not even do that. They will not even take the interview. Or if they go to the interview, will not go back to their boss, and definitely go for it. So that's something I really think is important. Jose Luis, I'm very happy for you. I think we have this millennial thing or, I don't know, course that they tell us that we don't stay long and we don't work hard. But I think it's the reverse. As you stated, you need to know your value in the market. And the important part is also don't value yourself because you are, let's say, egocentric. That you say, I value this because I think so. But do it based on the market. So you're an engineer, you're young, you went from Mexico to Belgium. You speak Spanish, English, French. You have certain abilities. Always value yourself. And as you said, just look around. Search what are they looking for? How much are they paying? What are their responsibilities, job roles, and so on. Now let's talk a little bit more on your current job. What do you do now in Puratos?
Yes.
So I think it's a very rough change going from your process engineering background and consulting and engineering services to this, I think it's a food industry. How will you classify Puratos?
Is a Belgian family-owned multinational food ingredient company. And what I do there, I am a project engineer of the engineering department of the headquarters. So again, based on my career, defined profile or defined path, but I'm again in CapEx projects. And based on the magnitude of the project, the magnitude of the budget, the resources available, and also the type of skill that are required, I'm assigned to this project either as the process engineer that needs to design from zero, or only just to with a supplier to follow up the engineering, or also to handle and coordinate and manage a few projects. So depending on the project and depending also of the project team, it's where we land. Is in charge of the distribution of the projects, and we do several projects around the world, which is really really interesting and really appealing to me. Since you get to work with a lot of nationalities in a lot of different sites, and it has been really really fun and exciting. I've learned a lot, and what Puratos does is that they have mainly three business units, which is called bakery ingredients, chocolate, patisserie, which is
like sweet. Baking, I don't know who.
Pastry, I think.
Yeah, pastry. Yeah. Yeah. So, Jose Luis, before we continue, yeah. Do you get to taste things?
Part of my welcome
job role.
My welcome on board training and workshops. I got to taste bread and then to prepare croissants and to awesome. It was really really nice. Yeah, my colleagues were like, "Ah, you're on holiday now. Enjoy. go and do your
croissant,
your croissant, and then you come. So, but it's nice. It's a really nice company.
And regarding the company, So you speak mostly English, French, both, maybe even Spanish, or how is it? How do you communicate? How do you think it helps or does not help the company?
It's mainly English. I work mainly in English, but the side language, let's say, is the French and Flemish. Flemish is like a dialect of Dutch, but most people, they also speak English. So I'd say 90% is English, then 5% is French, and the other 5% sometimes is Spanish. There are a lot of people speaking Spanish, which is really nice.
Mostly Spaniards or
no Belgians or or French guys that they love Spanish and they
that's cool. I think it's very diverse. Yeah. And well, French to Spanish, I think it's very easy to go from Spanish to French and French to Spanish. Yeah. So that's awesome. Yeah. Now, regarding this company, you said that it was a family-owned company. Yeah. I think it's very strange for a chemical engineer to work in family-owned companies. So tell us a little bit more about this. Does this is reflecting the company culture, or is it just like a random fact and it actually doesn't reflect in the company?
Even though it's a family-owned, it's quite big, I'll say. Puratos has branches in 68 countries and factories are around 40 to 45 countries. And there are around 70,000 employees. So it's a really, really, really big company. And the fact that it's finally owned is the interaction with the Puratos family and what they call the Puratos magic. It's really called the Puratos magic. They really listen to what the people working in Puratos has to say. In this year and a half that I've been there, I've seen changes based on this polls or exercises or workshops with the employees and also with the whole Puratos family. So I think that's where the family-owned label, if we want to mention like this, you feel it. You really, really, really feel it. And that, I think that's pretty much it. I have to say that in 2019, last year, it was awarded as the best place to work in Belgium.
Oh, that's nice.
Yes. So when they create any pool or they require any feedback, more than 90% of the people are happy to work in Puratos. So that's really, really high.
That's very important for the workplace and culture. Yeah. That's great. Actually, regarding that, how many internationals are working there?
In the headquarters, I think there are, I'll say 50-50. 50 either Belgians, Walloonians, Flemish, and then 50 expats.
Okay.
I'll say that. But I don't have the exact number, but on Notion.
I trust you. I trust you. Your criteria.
I can speak for my department, the engineer department. There are 5 Belgians and we are 5 non-Belgians. One from Ukraine, one from Brazil, from Venezuela, the Mexican, and I'm missing someone. But okay.
Asia, Africa?
No. We also have a colleague from India and another one in Brazil. So
nice. Almost every continent.
It's really nice.
So Jose Luis, can you explain us the distribution of how the percentage of how much time do you get to go to the office? How much time do you get to go to the actual plants or projects? How is it?
Well, now in COVID times.
Well, before COVID times.
No. Before COVID times, it was 20%, 20-30% at the office, 70-80% traveling. So it was quite it was quite intense.
So traveling, you mean? Actually, in 1 week, you travel 2 to 3 days?
2 to 3 days.
Or how is...
Yeah. Or sometimes, 2 weeks in a row. It depends.
So tell us...
For example,
tell us more... Sorry to interrupt you. Can you tell us more on that part of the... I think we don't talk that much about the travel part of the life balance, work-life balance, when we need to include travel work. So can you tell us... Is it exhausting? Do you love it? Is it okay? What How do you balance this with your wife?
Well, first I have to say that all when I travel, at least it was because it was really, really necessary. Because even though that now we have a lot of tools, and after COVID, we will need to adapt and create more tools to be able to do a lot of things remotely. There's nothing as human interaction and also space perception that to be in place, and also for my type of work, when sometimes we have to do installations and or to do how the existing facilities are, there's nothing better than to go and see. And then, yeah, so that's the first thing. Then it is really, really, I would say, exciting, but because at the same time, when you visit different colleagues around the world, you get to know them, and also you get to know different ways of working, and you also develop friendship and connection. But as you said, it can also be a bit tiring, and that's why sometimes to make a travel has to be really, really, you try to be as necessary, as mandatory as possible. And then for how I balance this with my wife also, back then she used to travel a lot, so I think it was the same for us. We were both
in the same page
traveling, and then make them.
So which places did you travel the most?
I've been going a lot to Switzerland, within Europe, to France, to Spain. I had the opportunity to go to Argentina and to Chile, which was really, really nice. Turkey, where it depends on the projects. Where the project is where we have to go.
You go there for mostly going for project management or service engineering? What do you do there?
It depends on the type of project and the project team. It really variates on the type of on the budget that is going to be used. If the local team has enough resources, if it's also, yeah, it varies a lot. But it can be as I mentioned, as pure and AutoCAD engineering, all the way just to see a supplier and try to
Okay.
It can be.
So it's very broad. I think that's, what's the name of your job position?
Project engineer, group project engineer.
Project engineer. Yeah, sounds very dynamic.
Yeah, it is.
So Jose, you were saying me that you could select when to go or not. Do you have a say whether or not you will or want to travel, or is it mandatory, or is it depending on the team, or is it because it's your project and you want to carry it on correctly? How do you, or what's the criteria for your travel?
It's a good question. They really, my boss and the project team and everybody, when you do a trip with DFDS, I don't think we need really to justify it. Just honestly, I don't know. That's a really good question. Nope. I don't know.
Okay. No, it's fine. It's fine. Yeah. I get the idea. So it depends mostly on the team. So I also not on team, mostly on the, let's say, inside clients. I don't know how to say
inside
them.
Clients.
So
yes.
If they require you, you will need to go. Yeah. Jose Luis, what do you want to add to this experience? Or I also have a question on, in general, this is not related to engineering, but definitely to a chemical engineer going abroad. So before we pass there, do you want to add something related to your current job?
No, not really. I think I've mentioned everything. I mentioned the
I think so. It's good information to let others know how a chemical engineer end up in a pastry and bakery, chocolates, which it sounds maybe related to the food industry or maybe even to chefs. But actually, all these materials or substances that go inside food are chemicals that are produced in bulk machines and processes. So definitely engineering and chemical engineering are related there. So Jose Luis, about the, let's say, work-life change, let us compare Mexican, or what do you have before and now? What do you see its benefits of being there in Belgium versus, I don't know, some things that you will prefer to be in Mexico?
I think I previously had the wrong image or the wrong impression about the differences between my Mexico and Belgium. Because before, I used to think that the main difference were the holidays. or are the holidays and
vacations? You
yeah,
mean?
yeah, the vacation.
Okay, the amount of day amount free. Of,
yeah, exactly. But as the years have passed, I know friends of us that they work in Mexico, and they have really really good amount of holidays and also a really really good salary. So I now I don't know. I don't know that the
you're questioning yourself.
Yeah, I'm questioning myself because before I had like a lot of difference, but now I couldn't precise something. But if I have to choose, I'll say just the amount of holidays, the average amount of holidays for a normal people and for normal employees.
Yeah, because for our friends out there in Mexico, we don't get that many free time. Mm. We get like the first year, typically you will not get any vacations. Exactly. And second, third years will be about in a average or by law, it's say 6 days. Mm. But typically you will get something in between 8 and 10 days, mm. which translate to maybe 2 weeks vacations. Mm. But in Belgium, can you let us know about the vacations laws and what have you gotten on your companies?
The first year, I think you don't have any holidays. And then it really is really different from company to company, but it goes between 20 and 30 days per year. And but there are other companies that give much more, and there are companies that by year they give one more, or there are companies that every 5 years give one more. So it really is different from one company to another. So but that's the range, let's say from 20 to let's say 40. But I have colleagues that they have 50. So but they are really really senior. So
no, that's crazy. 50 days.
It's crazy, yes.
Which means, doesn't mean 50 days in the year. It means more because you can add all the weekends. So it's almost like 2 months. And another question, will they allow you to take that much time off? Or do you need to strategically set up, let's say, 1 week here, then 2 weeks, then 1 month?
Yeah,
do you need...
you cannot take all of them in one go. You have to distribute them all over the year. I think that in my company now, the max is 3 weeks, I think.
3 weeks in a row.
3 weeks in a row, yes. And you have to tell in advance, like 3 to 6 months in advance, that you're going to take them, which I think is going in line.
Of course. Can you let us know more on the culture for all our friends that are not or haven't been working in Belgium? How is it? Do you like it? Is it easy to work with a international environment with Belgians? Or do you feel some like... friction between the nationalities and so on? Can you let us know, Jose Luis?
I think it's quite flexible here. You are quite free, but at the same time responsible for what you do and the time that you do it. It's more results oriented. And regarding the Belgians and the expats in general, over my short experience, I had good colleagues. I think you also need to adapt sometimes. And specifically, I could not tell right away, but I think the collaboration in general is really really good, and yeah, no frictions per se. I won't say no normal frictions at work. I think everybody have sometimes.
That's great, definitely. Because I would say in Mexico, maybe the main issue will be the language, but otherwise, I think we are always open to work.
Yeah,
directly. I don't know. It's business, right? It's not the, like personal life or if you are friends or not. It's only business.
Yes, it's only business. But no, they're happy people, really welcoming people.
Nice to hear from you, which you are also, I will consider, a happy, open guy, and your wife as well. So
thank you.
Say hi to Maria.
Yeah,
on my part. Jose Luis, now let's pass to the quick questions. Woo! I divided these into study life, professional life, and random facts. Okay. So let's start with study life. Okay, so if you could go back in time, what would you change from your bachelor life? And I don't mean exactly your content, but rather what would you do different?
Oui. I think I will try to study more automation.
That's a very nice tip, because Luis.
Yeah,
I wouldn't expect that from you.
Study automation.
Okay, control loops, yeah. More Laplace transforms. Yeah. Okay, why do you use it?
Yeah, I need to.
Okay, What would you add to your bachelor syllabus?
A bit more of finance.
Underrated stuff in chemical engineering.
Ura. No, there's not. No, nothing.
Even. Nothing. No. Overrated stuff in chemical engineering.
Parties. No, I'm joking. No, I don't know. You have good questions. No, no, parties are good. No, overrated. No, maybe. But that was fun also. A bit being part of chemical societies and I don't know, group, these kind of things. Okay, yes, I'll say that.
Let's not get offended people.
No. I was in those societies and I was like.
I also think so that when I was in the university, they always tell you, you need to go to these clubs and societies and all these.
And you have to make a congress, and which is nice. Exactly. It's funny. And yeah, but at the end, I could have used my time in something else. Automation, maybe.
True. Automation all the way. Okay, this one is nice. If you could select, let's say that, let's go back in time and you are not allowed to select chemical engineering as your study or profession. What would you change or select back then?
And another marketing.
Marketing. Yes. I wouldn't expect that from you, really. Yes. I would say maybe automation career.
No, a marketing. Or a soccer player, if it's possible. But that was not possible.
Taxes, probability, and statistics. Yes. Do you have a engineering book which is favorite or that you like a lot?
Yes, I do.
Which one?
I have the one of thermodynamics.
By Senghel, or which yes. one? And that's like a cool book. I like it.
And I think that's the only one I brought from Mexico.
Really? Do you use it as a reference?
I don't think so.
Actually, I'm going to add that question to my list. Which books do you use for reference? I think your favorite engineering subject?
I really enjoyed what we call ADP and DPQ.
Plant design and plant operation.
Plant design. Yes, I think that I really liked. To create the process.
Actually, like get all the engineering stuff that you learned through the years and actually put them to use.
Or rely on your colleagues as well. If it's possible, yeah.
Okay, and last one on student life. If you could select or meet any engineer or scientist of all the world, which one will you select?
I think I'll go, it might sound really mainstream, but I'll go with Mr. Bill Gates, because I've seen his passion and all the work that he put into. He was also really lucky. He was in the right time in the right place just him to learn from him and his desire and to learn. He's always like try to learn every time everything. And so
let's pass now to the professional life questions. Oh my God. Did you have any, let's say, first jobs which were not related to chemical engineering?
I also did another internship in Coca-Cola. That it was I worked in a warehouse,
like moving stuff or control inventory.
It was improving their picking procedures to try to to grow without grow without the need of new people and new operators. That was not chemical engineering at all, and I like it. It was fun.
Would you recommend that experience for youngers?
Yes, to know. It was a 4-month internship to know if you really like it or not.
Who would you like to trade jobs with? Maybe you one day, 1 week, 1 month, 1 year, but you know that you're going back to reality.
I would like to trade jobs with a teacher.
Any subject specific?
And no. Just
maybe if the company offer you, you can be a 1 year teacher and then you can come back.
That'll be nice.
You will be happy.
Yes, that'll be great.
So it can be related, but not. What is your dream job?
My dream job. I think I don't have any dream job. That's sad.
That's really, really sad. It's very hard to imagine a dream job. Actually, it's very I don't have a dream job as well. I just try to make a dream life, which typically has a dream job, but doesn't necessarily have to be that job.
I don't know if that the same expression exists in English, but if you love what you do, it's not a job. No, that's what they say.
Okay.
So maybe.
Yeah, I've heard that in English. I think it's you do what you love and love what you do. That's what Gianni said in the interview, in the last interview, and I actually love that part. Yeah. If you love what you do what you love.
So,
okay.
No dream job, so, but
something that you love.
Yeah, more sunny and days at the beach.
Okay. Underrated jobs in chemical engineering that we don't offer that much value, or maybe if we say, nah, don't go to that area or job.
Oof. I think it's perception. And as you said before, that it's a tricky one, but no, it's not underrated. It's something I don't like. I don't like maintenance. But without maintenance and more preventive maintenance, I think, you have enormous losses. So potential enormous losses. So I'll say maintenance.
Yeah, that's something I learned in the hard way back in the job, that maintenance is almost everything. And the worst thing is that typically in manufacturing industry, maintenance is like, oh, we don't like it. We don't like to spend on that.
We don't like to spend on that. Yes,
exactly. We want to wait for it to break and then we do maintenance on it. Because the problem with maintenance is that you don't see the like a car, even talking in very simple terms, when you make maintenance in a car, you don't see the effects because the car is already working and you're spending money and you're not seeing the benefit. Mm. But in the long run, you see it. And it's hard because in the long run, you don't see it actually. You see a process which is working perfectly. Mm. So yeah, maintenance, definitely a nice underrated job. Okay, what's the best advice you were given?
The best advice I got, I try to keep it in mind all the time, was in Colima. A guy that left, he told us, like, work hard, but don't be like, don't become an alcoholic, because he had like, I don't know, 50 to, I don't know how many years of experience. And he said, I've met a lot of people that try to, I don't know, prove themselves and so on and so forth, and they lose their families, or they become really ill, or, you know, so that's my advice, work, but not to the point that it becomes really harmful for you and for the people around you.
That, true. Don't get lost in the job,
which is really easy sometimes.
Yeah, that's true. And the problem is that it's very, like, step by step, day by day, yes, slowly, like dripping one drop. They say, yeah, it's only one drop, but eventually it becomes like a huge ocean. Talking about advices, what was the worst advice you were given and by who? Or you don't need to say the name, but maybe position? Or...
Yeah, by who was really the worst advice? I don't know. I tend to forget.
Or something that maybe you hear as advice and you say, nah, that's bullshit.
I don't know, man.
You were not given bad advices. I have a lot of advices that are...
Tell me one so I can next time.
The corporate ladder advice,
yeah,
work hard, and yeah, your work will be seen. That's one thing I would say. No, you need to make respect yourself and you need to show your work, not only work and wait for others to value you and wait for you. So that's when I will say, but that's just what comes into mind. Maybe that's what I ask. There are people that always say, oh, I got this worst. It's very bad advice. But if you don't have it, that's fine, because it means that you don't have this advice in mind. Or maybe you have it, but you don't care that much about it. So that's,
fuck life,
in my opinion, better, because you don't have it present.
YOLO.
YOLO. Okay. And what's the future of chemical engineering? Do you think there's a future? Because nowadays, I don't know about you, but I read a lot of young, let's say, high school students, or maybe even chemical engineering students that see, or recent graduates that see, that there is not that broad applications to chemical engineering. I would say that might be the case, but I'm still sure that chemicals engineers are required in the world. So what do you think is the future of chemical engineering?
In my humble opinion, I think chemical engineers and engineers in general, we make everything work, no? All professions, all people have their own role in the world, in society, and economy to make it happen. But I think at the end of the day, engineers really, really make it tangible happen, no? I think we are really, really important based on linked to chemical engineering. I think our efforts need to be into create more sustainable processes that require less of a footprint or less of weight. I think that's the future of or that should be the future of engineering. We had a conversation, you and me, a while ago, when I asked you actually for advice, technical chemical engineering advice, and the conclusion was, okay, maybe it's wrong what I'm going to say, but okay, let's use just water because water is cheap. But at the end of the day, this mindset needs to change, and also needs to change not only for water but all resources. So that, for me, that's what the future of chemical engineering should be. And also automation. Let me say it again. Automation.
Okay.
Yeah.
I will change the episode title to Jose Luis Farias, the automation guy.
No, but really, I see it more and more.
Actually, if you're going to work with machines, automation is for sure going to be there. The main problem is that with chemical engineers always say, oh, I know about it, but there's always going to be someone that actually knows that.
Knows it better.
So that, I think that's the problem or the mindset.
Yes, I need to get a notion of it. It's important. That's my humble opinion. I don't know.
No, that's the point. These are just questions and opinions. It's not the truth or false or correct or incorrect. Now, random facts, which are easier, Jose Luis. Coffee, tea, or energy drink, but since I know that in Europe you can drink a job, beer in the workplace for activation. So what do you drink to activate yourself in the work?
Coffee.
Nice. What's your favorite series or series that you would recommend to fellow chemical engineers?
Breaking Bad.
The top one chemical engineering series you gotta see or watch. Do you have any hobbies?
Yes, I like to read. I start doing some bicycle.
Like outdoor or?
Yeah, outdoor, when the weather is nice.
So you mean almost like 2-3 days in the year?
Yes.
Okay. Do you have a hobby that you want to develop in the future that you have in maybe, I don't know, play piano, and you have this dream, but you haven't worked on it, but you want to have this hobby?
I would like to learn how to sing.
Wow. That's. I wouldn't expect that from you. And that's nice.
Awesome. For my 25th anniversary, I could sing to Maria.
I hope to be there present
of course.
And hear you. And finally, what's the sport that you practice the most?
And now I go to the gym, I walk, but before was soccer and basketball. We, for the people that they don't know, Emma and I, we were champions at the university. So
that's true. It was awesome.
It was really good.
Epic. I remember those basketball years were cool because it kind of, I underrated those plays or games.
Yes.
And right now it's like, it was pretty cool to have a match with other fellow basketball players.
Just for the fun.
Exactly. So definitely, guys, try to get the most of your extracurricular life in the university. If you have sports, use them. So those were the quick questions, Jose Luis. I don't know if you want to make a last conclusion on the episode. Do you like it or not? Or what would you want to hear or whatever you want to add, especially to your experience or maybe tips for students, whatever you want to add is welcome.
No, thank you. Thank you very much again for the invitation. I had a great time also to catch up before the interview. For the fellow colleagues, as you just said, it sounds maybe really tacky or no cliche, but enjoy the ride, enjoy the studies. Try to find something that you really like, because you're gonna be doing that for the rest of your life if you follow the path. That path, you can also be
you can always change path.
You can start your business or whatever, but if you're gonna follow the working class path, try to choose something that you really like. I don't remember what I answered, but I hope the things that I said were okay. And looking forward to also listen to other chemical engineers and to other colleagues that are not in the field. That what chemical engineering give us is also a mindset that can be applicable not only in engineering but in all other fields.
I really like that last point. Chemical engineering is not only like this bachelor or set of knowledge. It's also a mindset. When you're a chemical engineer, as you also stated before, you're a problem solver. So that's the point of an engineer overall, to solve problems, help society, help community, and so on. So Jose Luis, thank you once again for being part of this show. I'm pretty happy that you decided to join us, and I'm sure that you were excited when I told you we were going to repeat this interview maybe in the future.
Yes.
And once again, thank you, guys. We will see you. If you want to, I might add some contact information for Jose Luis if you guys want to connect with him, maybe ask him about his experiences or jobs or whatever you might come to your mind. I will be adding the contact information in the blog post for this episode. So that will be it, guys. Take care. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thanks for joining us. I hope you enjoyed the episode. And before you go, I will really appreciate it if you take the time to share this podcast with your fellow colleagues, classmates, friends, or really anyone that might be interested on the topic of chemical engineering and its related fields. If you found this content helpful and valuable, please consider subscribing, rating, and leaving a review. Thank you so much for your support. It really means a lot.